The country's Weather Bureau again in the spotlight following the huge number of casualties caused by severe tropical storm Paeng. Now, some say there's a problem with communication and messaging. Others say PAGASA can only do so much. Joining us in Top Story, we have Esperanza Kayanan, Deputy Administrator for Research and Development of PAGASA. Dr. Kayanan, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron, and good afternoon to our viewers.
Dr. Kayanan, in a recent press briefing, President Marcos asked why there was supposedly no warning that the rains would bring that much flooding in Maguindanao. Now let's break down that question to clarify the issue. Was PAGASA able to forecast Paeng's track as accurate as it could from the available data that you had?
Actually, with regards to Paeng's track, we have provided advanced forecast track as early as around 2 to 3 days before. Mm-hmm. But due to the changing environment, the forecast track varies almost every day because of the weather systems affecting the tropical cyclone. So the environment is very unstable, and many of the models do not agree with each other, so we are having a hard time to really give a exact forecast track. But since we are giving adjusting or giving forecast every 6 hours, or we are releasing severe tropical cyclone bulletin every 6 hours, so we are changing the forecast track as based on the available data to our forecasters. So it's not only the PAGASA Forecasting Center, but also mm-hmm. other international warning centers are having the same problem.
Right,
so
but
I, yes.
Go ahead,
yes,
go ahead, ma'am. Go ahead.
So we cannot say that this is a regular or this is more or less a different one, not following a regular track, unlike mm-hmm. the other weather systems, which the environment is not varying very, very much.
But whenever there is a tropical cyclone in the country, you do give hourly updates as well, right?
Yeah, we do. And of course, our severe weather bulletin is being issued every 3 hours before the 1 day before the tropical cyclone approached the landmass.
And we always do report about that. Another question, did PAGASA foresee the amount of rain that Paeng would bring prior to its arrival?
Actually, we have an estimate of amount of rainfall that the Paeng would bring. And this is also based on our numerical models. And we are providing this forecast rainfall to MGB. And the Mines and Geoscience Bureau is providing the NDRRMC members and releasing the advisories for areas susceptible to landslides and floodings.
Mm-hmm. Is PAGASA directly communicating with local government units? Just to clarify that last thing you said, is there a direct line from PAGASA to local government units to warn them of the areas that will be affected by a storm?
So for the national government, the headquarters, we are providing directly to Office of Civil Defense and the NDRRMC members mm-hmm. and DILGs. But for the local areas, we have regional centers all over this. So they are the ones communicating with the local LGUs in their area. So, and also they are also conducting pre-disaster risk assessment meetings, not only the national regions or the local areas.
So, Dr. Kayanan, in the case of Paeng, your regional bureaus should have been the one communicating with the local government units. Did they warn the local government units of those areas that will be affected by Paeng about the amount of rainfall that Paeng would bring in their areas?
With regards to Mindanao, providing the advisories and also, but I'm not so sure if they did their their Zoom meeting or face-to-face meeting or PIDRA meeting. But we are providing them through our communication system, through email, fax, and the telephone call. So we are providing them the fees.
Okay, so through possible Zoom meetings, and SMS, calls, and emails, all information.
And also the heavy rainfall warnings.
Okay, Dr. Kayanan, some may have noted that there may be perhaps
our forecasters attend the Zoom meetings.
Right. Okay. Now, some...
Hello, I think our communication is not so good.
Can you hear me now, Dr. Kayanan?
Yes,
okay,
Ron.
Okay, there. Now, some may have noted that there may be perhaps a problem with the messaging of PAGASA, the way it delivers its communication. Mm-hmm. And this is not the first time that it's been raised. I remember this being raised also during the Noynoy Aquino administration. Has PAGASA tweaked or improved the way it delivers its forecasts to local governments and the public that is, you know, easily understandable and not so much jargon?
I think that problem on jargons or laymanization is still not totally addressed, because right after the Yolanda, we have conducted information education campaign all over the country, and right now we have an ongoing project which is called Maghanda, wherein we are conducting sessions with LGUs, with our responders, and the media all over the country from north to south. But with this event like that happened in Mindanao, actually we have not yet conducted our IEC with BARM. It is scheduled this coming November, I think November 9 and 10 for BARM. But we have conducted IEC with other areas in Mindanao, and we have make up sessions. So unfortunately, the BARM has not yet been conducted. The IEC in BARM has not yet been conducted. So we still have, I think the gap is still there. And actually, we have worked with the Sangguniang Wikang Pambansa before on how to communicate. So we have already some Filipino translations, but until now, I think there's still a lot more to do because of the gaps that we have been seeing now. So communication is still the problem. And we need to work harder. And I think we need the cooperation of everybody, especially the LGUs and the Filipino people that are getting our information.
And we'll try to help as much as we can as well, Dr. Kayanan. Now, speaking of BARM, there was a minister the other day, I think it was a minister of the Interior and Local Government, he said that they could have better prepared for Paeng if they were given a more accurate forecast of the amount of rain and which specific areas would get hit. Now, but would these kinds of, maybe we could call them insinuations, almost somehow blaming PAGASA for that, would these kinds of insinuation that PAGASA could have done better, how do the people of the agency feel about those comments?
Well, actually, we welcome comments to improve our services, but we would also like to express that we are doing our best, and actually, we have the numerical values for forecast for specific areas because we have the numerical model outputs. We can use our WARF model, and maybe we had a meeting with our secretary and how we would be able to provide this information needed as mentioned, but we are having some thoughts also because sometimes these values does not really mean action. So we are looking at how we could provide this information, but again, this should not cause any other problem. So we are looking at the impacts rather than the amount of rainfall, because sometimes the values cannot really need provide exact information because sometimes these values will not fall exactly on the on their town. The rainfall is really variable, so we are studying on how we could provide a better information, but I think impact-based forecast is actually we are working on that impact-based forecasting, so that they should know the impacts rather than the amount of rainfall per specific area. So we also need some information about on the ground.
Okay, let's talk about the development of the agency over the years. Have there been improvements made in recent years to the forecasting system of PAGASA, most especially since the enactment of the PAGASA Modernization Act, which started, I believe, 2015? Have we had better and more equipment since then?
Actually, with regards to our equipment, we were able to acquire modern equipments for the radars. We have actually 19 radars installed. Two of them are still being installed right now in Pangasinan and in Masbate. And aside from the radars, unfortunately, some radars have been destroyed by strong typhoons, but this will be repaired. So when it comes to radar, we are expecting 20 radars, Doppler radars, by the end of the year. Mm-hmm. And aside from the big Doppler radars that we are having, we also have seven smaller radars with a radius of around 100 kilometers, which are focused on the different river basins all over the country, particularly in Mindanao. We have four X-band or small radars for the different river basins. We have also installed flood early warning systems in the 18 major river basins in the Philippines. And unfortunately for Mindanao River Basin, it was just recently completed and training was just finished last week. So unfortunately, we were not able to use this for the Mindanao event. But this is already completed, and we're going to have IEC for the implementation of the flood early warning system in Mindanao River Basin. Another concern for the modernization is the personnel requirement, because we have added more station, flood early warning centers, but we lack personnel to man this station. So that is the part of the modernization that has not yet been completed. Mm-hmm. We have added radar stations, but in terms of personnel, that is not yet implemented.
Dr. Kayanan,
so we need it.
Right. Yes, we reported a while ago that the former NDRRMC chief, Alexander Pama, did say that the Tampakan Doppler radar has been broken. How long has it been broken, and when can it be repaired?
Actually, the Tampakan radar was affected by the earthquake. I think that was more than a year ago. And the building is really affected, that the DPWH said that we cannot use the building anymore, and as well as the equipment is also not working. So we are planning to relocate or make another station near the area that will cover more or less the same area. So we're not going to repair the Tampakan radar because of that issue, but we will be looking for another area to install that radar.
Could that have been an issue? Could you have made a better forecast if the Tampakan Doppler radar was fixed?
I don't think so, because we have other radars working.
Okay.
We have radars in Visayas and in Bohol, which can cover Mindanao. And as I mentioned, we have already installed smaller radars over Mindanao area, which will monitor the river basins. So I believe that that's not really the main problem with that. We have Bohol radar, which is really new, and it is already operating, and we have K1 radar also.
Okay, so thanks for clarifying that. Dr. Kayanan, for next year, the budget for PAGASA has been actually cut by around, if I'm not mistaken, 40 million pesos. from this year's allotment. How much is that going to affect the operations of PAGASA?
Actually, one concern of PAGASA is that we do not have capital outlay. So right. if we are going to purchase new equipment, we have to do what we have last year. And if we program, we need to have some budget for actually for Virac radar, which is supposed to be, we have to repair it and to put it up. So we have no capital outlay for 2023.
So that means you don't have enough money to buy new additional equipment.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, for repairs, since if there are to be repairs, if those were not accounted for in our proposals, if there will be something that will, hopefully, our equipment will not be affected by natural hazards. But if something happened, which is not computed for major repairs, then maybe our budget will
is it true that the agency has had no additional budget for new equipment for the past 2 years?
Yeah, this year we have none also. So 2022 and 2023, no.
But why is that?
Prior to that, we have. Because we have some maybe we have some funds before, which mm-hmm. is... since I don't know, but this is just my idea. Since we have some funds before the pandemic, which is being continued, because during the pandemic, some of the purchase or acquisition is affected by the pandemic. So there are still some for those left to be completed, but if we have to buy new ones, we do not have. So I guess this is the concern of those who mm-hmm, mm-hmm. because I think we have proposed, but unfortunately, since maybe the budget for the entire country is affected by the inflation and by the problems that we're having due to COVID. So,
right, but
I don't know.
PAGASA is still going to be important, most especially since, it was President Marcos who did say that he was informed that there were four more storms coming in
yes.
before the year ends. And, of course, the storms that will be coming in the next years, and they are becoming stronger and more violent. There may be still some time for the budget to be possibly tweaked by Congress. What yes. would be PAGASA's wish list of what else it would need? You did say already about manpower. You need more specialists.
Yeah. Yes, else? We need. Basically, manpower is the number one requirement right now because of the new stations that were established. Not only radar stations and flood early warning centers, but also we have added weather stations in the different provinces. Of course, we need equipment for the radar of Virac and maybe possibly other equipment, still other equipment that we need. Mm-hmm. So hopefully, I think our senators and our congressmen know the real situation. I think someone has already, I think there's a proposal from a governor or congressman for the Tampakan replacement.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I think it was submitted to NEDA. But hopefully, this will be addressed also.
We're hoping for that as well. Yeah. Dr. Esperanza Kayanan, she's a Deputy Administrator for Research and Development of PAGASA. Dr. Kayanan, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Ron. Good afternoon.